The next talk is by Amr Friedland, formerly from Paris 6, now from Sorbonne, and the title is...
So thank you, Shiri, for this, and Shlomit, for this amazing conference. So far, we'll see what happened after my talk. Anyway, Sasha Litvak, me also, I'm a student of Vitali, by the way, and even before Sasha Sodin. So I met Vitali Milman for the first time as a third-year student in his functional analysis course. And I still have this vivid memory of Vitali running everywhere, full with excitement, energy, passion, writing all over the board. Not even one word, of course, in Hebrew. And I just came from India, and I said to myself, wow, this is like a guru. So so let me show you just two photos. So this is Vitali in our 2007 research seminar. And this is a problem that he likes very much. Probably at the end you will talk about it, who knows. And already here you see the energy of Vitali, and this is another photo of Vitali. This is related to the Moreau-Pizier problem. And this is essentially the only asymptotic geometric analysis subject in this talk, okay? So just to remind you for later. So then, of course, for me it was very natural to, natural candidate for me to is to come to Vitali and to ask him if he would like to be my advisor. Of course, I came afraid. I didn't know who is Vitali. I didn't know how remarkable person and mathematician is. And I just came asking Vitali, can you be my advisor? Of course, he took control of the conversation completely. And then he grabbed the book of that he wrote with Gidon. He told me, read the first chapter about constructing Haar measure on the sphere. Come to me, see me on Wednesday at 10 o'clock. But before, don't forget to write your name and telephone on the left upper corner of his board. And this is still there. So if you're looking for the telephone of Shiri, Boaz, Sasha, Ronen, whatever, or you will Google this photo on the internet, or you go to Vitali's office, everything is stable. So just now, final remark about Roy's talk. So when I finished my master, I also accepted to a PhD program in neuroscience in Weizmann Institute, and I didn't know which direction I should go. And of course, I came to Vitali, and he has very solid ideas on everything, as you know. And I came to him, Vitali, what should I do? And actually, this was the question from yesterday. What is mathematics about? What do we do here? So he told me. I didn't manage to answer, of course. He told me, we do neuroscience. We study the human mind. We study the way we think. And you see, I'm here, so this is the answer for you. And last thing maybe, so of course, Vitali influenced a lot my mathematical life, but also my personal life. So in 2006, I was in this semester in Paris. I met my wife, so thank you again. And I have a beautiful family, so thank you again, Vitali. Now, maybe the last thing I can consider myself already not so young anymore, at least not young researcher anymore. So in Hebrew, there is this phrase in Pirkei Avot, so ask your neighbors if you don't understand what I say now. In Hebrew, you said, Taseh lecha rabbi, or in English, probably make yourself a rabbi. I don't know if it's the right translation. And Gluskin is not here, but for me, the rabbi is Vitali. So Vitali, thank you again. Happy birthday. And above all, I wish good health to you and all the surrounding people. Good, so now a little bit about mathematics. So I'm going to speak about absolutely classical result in analysis, and it's a joint work with Evgeny Abakumov from Marne-la-Vallée and Yossi Yomdin. And actually, I'm interested in uncertainty principles. And so the classical one is, which was established by Heisenberg, points out a fundamental problem in quantum mechanics, that the position, all of you know that, the position and momentum of a particle cannot both be determined explicitly, but only in a probabilistic terms within a certain uncertainty. But in the language of mathematics, this is one of the main manifestations, is that for a compactly supported function, its Fourier transform is entire function, analytic function, with discrete zero sets, and therefore cannot be compactly supported. So this leads to the following general, so we are concerned in this, the following general uncertainty principles. So we have a non-zero function, and you look at this function and its Fourier transform, and we would like that both cannot be localized in small sets. Of course, have to be, everything has to be quantified. And this leads for the this classical definition of annihilating pairs. So we said that the two sets, S and sigma, two measurable sets in Rn. So the pair S and sigma is called weakly annihilating if we have this implication. So the support of F is in S. The support of the Fourier transform is in sigma. This implies that, in fact, the function is a zero function. And we have the strongly annihilating pair. If there is a constant for L2, for each L2 function, we have this inequality. So the L2 function, the L2 norm is bounded from above by the L2 norm of F on the complement of S and the L2 norm of the Fourier transform on the complement on sigma. Okay. And as I said, those are completely classical notions, so there are a lot, many results, so I just will mention a few. But typical questions are, what is the relation between those two notions, weakly and strongly annihilating pairs? What can be said about the set, S and sigma? And what can be said about, the, of course, about the constant? So clearly, a strong pair implies a weak pair. So this is just from the definition. And that's what I just mentioned before, the uncertainty principle, the main manifestation says that actually any pair, S sigma, is weakly annihilating if the two sets are compact sets. And then Benedict's in 85 has shown that the pair S and sigma is weakly annihilating if the two sets are of finite Lebesgue measure. And then, it's not a mistake, Amrian Berthier in 77 showed that under the same assumption, in fact, the strong is strong, the pair is strong. So here I would just, it's just a remark. Everything is correct here. So the weaker result is the later one. And it's not by mistake. So this is the risk that I'm taking in this talk. In analysis, it happens quite often that we prove, reprove, and reprove the same result, and sometimes even the weaker form. So this is exactly what happened here. So this is, you sure? Okay, so this is exactly what I said. This is my risk. This is exactly my risk. Misha, this is exactly what I said. So it's possible that some of the things that I will mention, you can, I would like you to remark me because we are working on a land which I'm not completely feel secure. Anyway, in 93, Nazarov in his thesis actually studied the constant, and at least in the one-dimensional case, he obtained an optimal constant, which is exponent to the power of the Lebesgue measure of S and sigma. And then Germain in 2007 generalized this result to any dimension, so we get the 1 over n over there, but the cost that one of the sets has to be convex. So this is another relation to this convexity seminar. But anyway, this is still open whether this convexity assumption can be dropped. What I would like to emphasize that those two results are heavily relied on the Turan-Nazarov inequality. It was Turan inequality, and then Nazarov at the same work actually improved Turan's inequality. And Turan-Nazarov inequality, to those that don't familiar with those inequalities, is just a Remes type inequality for exponential polynomials. And if you don't know what is a Remes type inequality, I will explain in a short time. Anyway, this inequality was generalized by Yossi and myself in 2013 to a discrete set and even to finite sets, and of course to higher dimensions. Okay. Now this is a, so this is one of the main questions, actually. Can we characterize all the strong annihilating pairs? And this seems to be out of reach. But there is a very nice description of all sets S forming a strong annihilating pair when sigma is bounded. in terms of the following notion, which is called relatively dense set. So what is a relatively dense set? We have a measurable set E, and we say it's relatively dense with constant L and gamma. If the Lebesgue measure of the translation, the intersection of E with the translation of the cube, this is bounded from below by L times gamma. For our sake, I wrote L, but you should think about it as one. Okay, this is if you think about normalization or something like this. Just think about L as one, you will see it in the proof. This is what I said, ignore the normalization, this is not important here. Think about L to be one. And Logvinenko Sereda actually proved in 1974 the following now classical description of strongly annihilating pairs. When S, the complement of S is a relatively dense set, and actually they prove that if S and sigma are two measurable sets in Rn, sigma is bounded, then the following two assertions are equivalent, so this pair is strong if and only if the complement of S is relatively dense. And any sigma bounded. This is the main thing here. I will explain why sigma doesn't play any role, and this is exactly this is the slide. So I recall that this is the definition of strongly annihilating pair, but actually Havin and Yurik actually in 94 showed that if F, if we have a function so that its Fourier transform is bounded in sigma, then those two inequalities are equivalent. So what we need to study is basically just the L, to study these kind of inequalities so that the L2 norm of F on Rn is bounded by a constant L2 norm of F on the complement of S. And this is exactly what we need. Now this kind of, so this is the main inequality that we are going to study. And in their jargon, or in the jargon or control theory, PDEs, they call it spectral theory of F. Logvinenko and Sereda also proved this inequality. So actually, so if F, so generalized to other values of P, so if F is an LP function, P between 1 and infinity, the support of the Fourier transform of F is in an interval, J, and E is a relatively dense set, then we have the following inequality. So this is the constant that they got, exponent of all those parameters. And E, as it's written over there, is just the complement of S, so everything is kosher. Now, in 2001, Kovrykin improved this and generalized this estimate, which was only for R, to higher dimension. And he proved that if F is LP function on Rn, and the support of the Fourier transform is inside the box of size R, and E, again, it's a relatively dense set, then we have the following inequality with this improved constant. Okay, so we bound the LP norm by the LP norm on E is this constant. What is interesting now is just I will do a detour just to emphasize the importance of this result from 2001 or the result of Logvinenko and Sereda, this type of result. So in order to use this result in the context of control theory in PDEs, it's important to understand how this constant depends on the set sigma. It's for you both. So, and thanks to this explicit dependence, actually, if you remember, sigma now is just the box of size R. So thanks to this explicit dependence of the constant in the parameter R, Egidi and Vasilich and Zhang, in 2018 and 2017, have independently established the following striking result, that the heat equation is non-controllable in any positive time for any measurable set E, if and only if this set is relatively dense. So before I will continue, Vitali laughed about this name. So one moment, Vitali. So I prepared you a trivia fact. In this great nation of China, more than 80% of the people share less than 100 different family names. So it's not a big surprise that we have this probability. So it's quite amazing. So I don't want to get to this. This is a really detour, but yes, in some sense, yes. But I will. Okay. So our goal is again to study the spectral inequality. So we would like to study under which conditions on the control set E, we have some kind of spectral inequality, and actually how the geometrical properties of E really related to this constant. And so the program here is I'm going to show you two results in which we generalize previous results, we improve some results, and also produce new results with control sets which are discrete, which is completely contradictory if you think about it with respect to control theory. So the program, so I'm going to present first to this structural Logvinenko Sereda result. And the idea is that it's quite simple, actually, the proof now. And this is, I think, our main contribution. I think we really understand, I hope you will, this result. It actually follows from an extremely simple observation. If we have a function which satisfies Remes type inequality and Berchen type inequality, then it satisfies a Logvinenko-Sereda result. And so I will give description of what is Berchen, what is Remes, and then I will give you the full proof, essentially. So Berchen inequality is the following inequality. We have a function, we said that it satisfies Berchen type inequality with constant tau. If we wish the LP norm of any derivative by the LP norm of F with a constant tau. This is a classical inequality satisfied by many different classes of functions. And for the important example for us in this case today, it's the space of, if you want, P Pali-Wiener space. So it's the space which we denote by PW tau P. So it's a space which consists of all entire functions, LP entire functions on C, such that the restriction to R is the usual LP function, and they satisfy this exponential type tau inequality. And when P is 2, everything is known. What I will say now, when P is between 1 and infinity, still we have this classical result, which says that the following assertions are equivalent. So F belongs to this class or to this space, but you should think about F as a function which extends to this space. Then it's equivalent to the fact that F actually satisfies a Berchen inequality in the following form. And lastly, it's the fact that F as a function of LP on R and the support of the Fourier transform is in this interval, all those assertions are equivalent. So if you wish, this is some kind of, again, uncertainty principle, because on one hand, we have a control on the LP norm of all the derivatives and F. This is the Berchen inequality. And the other one, which depends on this constant. And on the other hand, is we have the control on the support of the Fourier transform. So this is in some kind of uncertainty principle again. So this is a Berchen inequality. So what is Remes inequality? So Remes inequality, in general, it's very simple. You would like to bound the maxima of f on a set with the maxima of the function f, of the absolute value function of f on a subset. So more precisely, this is what we are looking for. So we would like to bound the supremum of f on I. In this case, we can be in Rn, we can be in R, it doesn't matter. We can be in Cn. It depends on the class of function that we are considering. We have this constant, which is called the Remes constant, and we have the supremum of F over E. Now, there is a trade-off here between what we know about E and the constant, of course. If E, as a measurable set, gets smaller and smaller, the Lebesgue measure gets smaller and smaller, and then we pay the penalty 1 over the Lebesgue measure of E. So this is, of course, the penalty that we have to pay. What is D? So D, it's the constant D. You should think about it something which depends on F, or in families. And normally D, in the case of polynomials, this is just the degree of the function. But in other classes, this is what we said, it depends on the combinatorial data that we have at hand. In the jargon is diagram, but then it could be the dimension of the ambient space, it could be the total degrees that we have in the system, in this family, the maximal frequency, etc. We will see some examples later. So this is Remes type inequality. But once you have Remes type inequality, you can have also this LP Remes type inequality, which is nothing but a simple LP norm estimate, the following one that we have here. So if a function satisfies a Remes type inequality, we have the following control on the LP norm. And this is classical, it's nothing new. This is absolutely classical, and as you see, this is exactly the Remes constant that we had before with some additional factor 1 over P, actually. And let me just show you the proof, because this is so classical that you should know. So we define the following set, E alpha. And E alpha is the set for which the absolute value of F is smaller than this constant. Okay, alpha is the parameter which replaces the measure of E before. And now apply the Remez inequality to this set. So we get that the supremum of F over I is smaller than this. Now we have the Lebesgue measure of E alpha as it should be. But the supremum actually is smaller than the constant because we are inside this set. So just replace the constant over there. Yes, so you can replace this constant. Oops, sorry. Okay, so the supremum here we can replace with this constant, and this is what we have here. Now everything cancels out, and what is left is just the fact that the Lebesgue measure of E alpha is smaller than alpha. Okay, so now we'll choose alpha, which is just the Lebesgue measure of E over 2. Very good, so it means that the complement inside E is bigger than the measure of E over 2. And for any X which is outside E alpha, but still in E, we have the other inequality. So now you just need to plug in everything inside. So the integral over E, of course, is bigger than the integral over E minus E alpha. Now the measure is bigger than the measure of E over 2 times the lower bound that we have, and that's about it. So this is a general scheme. Okay. Now we are at the point to, so we have Bernstein, we have Remez, and now we have to prove this following structural Logvinenko Sereda result. So we have a function which satisfies 4 and 5. This is just Bernstein and Remez. E is a relatively dense set, and we have the following theorem. So this is a general theorem or generic theorem. You just need to plug in the components, and then you get it. So the LP norm of F is bounded from above by the L double the norm of F on E with this constant. The constant from Kovrychkin. Four and five is just Remez inequality, Bernstein inequality. Okay, so we have three assumptions, function that satisfies those two inequalities plus the fact that E is a dense subset, a relatively dense subset. Okay, let's show the proof. I think it's a nice proof. So following Kovrychkin, we will rewrite the reals in the following way, just as a union of those intervals, n plus 1. And we will call an interval in this partition a bad interval if there exists an integer mi, which is the order of the derivative, such that we have the inverse Bernstein inequality, if you will. So this is exactly, so the integral of the derivative of order mi to the power p on I is bigger than the one of the function. If it's not the case, this is a good interval. And now we will study the 1/2, the LP norm of p to the power p. So instead of 1/2, I will plug in this infinite sum. And then we can apply here a Bernstein inequality. So this is bounded from below by Bernstein inequality by the integral over R of the derivative of order m of f to the power p. This is exactly Bernstein. Okay, so now instead of doing the integral over R, we'll do the integral over all bad intervals. All bad intervals, now this is what we have here. Now we can switch the order of summation, so we have a sum over all bad intervals of this infinite sum of integrals, but for each interval, bad interval, there exists this integer mi. So instead of taking the whole sum, I will just take the corresponding instance which corresponds to I, which is mi. So I will just take one term which corresponds to the I that we have. And that's about it. Now using inequality 7, this is comparable with the L norm of F on the bad intervals. So what did we get? So this is smaller than 1/2 of the LP norm. So it means that the good intervals are bigger than 1/2. Okay, so now it's essentially, it is done. So E, it's a relatively dense set. So it means that if I denote by EI the intersection, it means that the measure is bigger, the Lebesgue measure is bigger than gamma. Now we can apply the LP Remez type inequality, so with respect to EI. So this is what we got before, but this measure is bigger than gamma, and that's about it. Now we will sum up over all good intervals. This is true for any I, but you can sum up with respect to all good intervals. So the integral over E is bigger, of course, than the integral over E intersect with all the good intervals. And then you apply 9, and then you get integral with respect to all the good intervals, but all the good intervals are bigger than the LP norm, and that's about it. This is the structural theorem. Now, some remarks about this theorem, about the result. First, the first thing which is important, we don't really use the fact that it's relatively dense for any translation of the cube. We use something much less than this. We assume that E is relatively with respect to a very specific partition of R. And this is important for application. Whether you have I give you a set and you need to check it, so it's much easier to check with respect to a certain partition. Or on the other hand, if you want to build a set and you to construct a set such that it satisfies those assumptions. So this is actually very important. The second is now you need to plug in. You just need to plug in. If you have a function which satisfies Remes or Benson, you just plug in and you have this result. And of course, these kind of results are known for polynomial, exponential polynomials, and many other classes of sets. And using this procedure, we can prove and improve known results and also obtain new ones. So let me first show you that Kovrychkin result is just a simple fact now. So there is a Remes inequality for analytic functions. Here I don't give all the details because you need to say analytic function in certain domain which affects certain constants here. So the constants here actually are not absolute. This is a mistake here. It depends on the Remes constant for analytic functions. Then you have the theorem. If we have a function which is a polylinear function, we have better, but this is exactly the assumption that we have here. We have a function in LPRN. The Fourier transform is bounded in this box, so that's why we have a Bernstein. So we have all the assumptions that we need, and therefore we have this structural Logvinenko-Sereda result. The next thing that I would like to show you, this is in a recent paper that considered these kind of functions. So let P, this is an important example for them. So let P be a collection of all the polynomials of degree at most n, and let us denote by gn tilde. This is, I use the same notation, you will see where. So it's all the combination of shifted Gaussian with polynomial coefficients. And actually, so that the degree of those polynomials plus one is bounded by n. So this is a very big collection of functions. And recently, Thomas Erdely in 2006 and 2009 actually proved a Bernstein inequality and Remes type inequality exactly for this kind of, for this type of functions. So we have Bernstein inequality actually with explicit the tau constant is the one that we have here. And we have a Remes type inequality where D, which depends on F, now it's just N plus one. Now the constant, maybe I should say a word about this constant. This constant doesn't enter the conclusion of the theorem, so it's not, I don't really care about actually, he has something explicit. Okay, so thanks to those two estimates of Erdely and the fact that we have this control, the structural theorem, we have this spectral inequality, so we have a function which is here, and E is a relatively dense set, we have the following inequality. And this is we improve here a result, very recent result of Bouchard, Germain, and Pravda, Starov from 2018. And they prove similar results, a little bit weaker with the constant, and also for a smaller class of functions, just for standard Hermit functions. Okay. So now we would like to, so this is an important point now. So this is the structural theorem, and actually the main, over there it's so hot. So the main, one of the main building blocks of the theorem is Remes type inequality. And in some sense, Remes type inequality is non-optimal. It's non-optimal because we would like to measure the information of a set with the Lebesgue measure. This is not the right idea. So as I said before, there is this trade-off between the Lebesgue measure and the Remes constant, which behaves like 1 over the Lebesgue measure. But still, we can have discrete sets or even finite sets in a certain interval or in a certain compact domain such that the metric entropy of this set is positive. And this is much, this should be the right quantity that we should find in Remestab inequality. This is the idea. So we would like to replace the Lebesgue measure of E with another invariant which depends on the geometric properties of E and captures the information. So if we speak about information, we speak about the metric entropy of a set. So there is this notion which we call metric span, and it was introduced actually by Yossi in 2011 and then generalized in a series of papers with me also. And the idea is to replace the Lebesgue measure with a geometric, simple geometric invariant, which we denote by omega of E, and we call it the metric span of E. Now, it can be effectively estimated in terms of the metric entropy of the set. And what is important here, we can have discrete set, we can have even finite set, and we can have a Remes inequality for such sets. So let me just give you some properties and the difference between this metric span and the Lebesgue measure. So the idea is to construct a metric span which has the following properties. So it bounds the Lebesgue measure from above. So the omega of E is all the time bigger than the Lebesgue measure of E. So this could be zero and this could be something else. This is exactly what we want. Inequality is for sub-level set. And if we denote this level set of F relatively to E, because this is the factor, this is the main factor, that the most important factor. So if E is a finite set, so we take the supremum, so then it's just the maximum. So we take, if you want, the maximum of these points. And so this is the level set which corresponds to this set E. So first, of course, this E is a subset of V. And secondly, the Lebesgue measure of this sublevel set is bigger than the metric span. So in other words, the metric span is captured between the Lebesgue measure of E and the Lebesgue measure of the corresponding sublevel set of E. And of course, the main problem, and this, of course, I will not present you, the problem is to how to define this metric span, how to... this is the problem, is to construct such kind of invariants. And clearly, it's tailored to the class of functions that you work with. So if it's polynomials, it is known. Exponential polynomials, quasi-polynomials, analytic function, SP-valent function, P-valent function, solution of PDEs. It's huge. This notion is valid and well-defined for many different classes. Let me give you the actual example. So in 53-1, assume, so let's have the... Let's have the exponential polynomial P with parameters CK and lambda K. So the Turan-Lazarov inequality bounds, this is what I said, it's type of Remes type inequality, it bounds the maximum of the absolute value of P on I with respect to the absolute value of P on a subset. So Turan in 53 assumed that E is a subinterval, and the Nazarov in his thesis actually generalized it to any subset of positive measure. So this is a Turan-Lazarov inequality. And as you see, all the constant, we have additional constant in front. It's just, again, it's the Lebesgue measure of I and the maximal frequency, or the real part of the maximal frequency. But everything is good in this sense. Now, what is the metric span in this case? So what is the diagram? So again, the diagram is just the combinatorial data that we have for this class of functions. So we denote it by D. So it's just a vector of all these combinatorial data that we have. So M is just the degree. Lambda is the, in this case, it's the imaginary part of lambda k. So it's the maximal frequency, the imaginary part of the correct frequencies. And L is just the size of this interval. So then we define this quantity MD. It's not important, but most importantly is that what is this constant D here? So this constant D here comes from a Bizot type theorem for exponential polynomials. So this gives you how many zeros you have for this kind of equation, the absolute value of P equals zero, sorry. Okay, so if you have some kind of a uniform bound on the number of zeros, and you have control on the covering number of the set, then the metric span is defined in the following way. So it's just the metric entropy minus this uniform bound of zeros divided by 1 over epsilon, times 1 over epsilon, and then you take the supremum. So this is the metric span, which is tailored for the Turan-Lazarov inequality in the case of R. And once you have this, you can prove the following inequality. So what is important here, we replaced the Lebesgue measure by the metric span, the corresponding metric span. So the main ingredients here are two. First, we need the classical Turan-Azarov, unfortunately, to prove this inequality. And the second, as I said, once you have some kind of a Bezout-type theorem, once you have a Bezout-type theorem, you can also, this is one of the main ingredients in order to define a metric span. And in this case, for exponential polynomials, you use a Chovansky result from 91. Okay. So let's back to the Remes type inequalities, and I would like to replace in general the Lebesgue measure in the Remes type inequality by the metric span. So assume that you have a function for which we have a Remes type inequality with respect to the Lebesgue measure, and the metric span is well defined. In this case, we can have quite trivially a Remes type inequality for the metric span. So let's prove it, because this is funny in some sense. So we apply Remes type inequality to the sublevel set V, which corresponds to the set E. So we get this inequality. And by the definition of V, actually the supremum, just know that the supremum over V is just the supremum over E. And by the property that we said before, the metric span is bounded from above by the Lebesgue measure of V. So now you just need to replace. This can be replaced by the metric span. The supremum can be replaced by supremum over E. And voila, you get a Remes type inequality for a metric span, a positive metric span sets. Now, as I said before, it's not a problem, but actually we need the classical one in order to prove something in a sense stronger. Okay, and once, as before, I said if we have a Remes type inequality, then we can have the corresponding LP Remes type inequality. So in this case, we can prove something which is parallel to the LP Remes type inequality. We can prove something for the metric span. So this is the simple lemma again. So if P is between 1 and infinity, and E, it's just a subset of I with positive metric span. So then we can control the LP norm of F on I with a constant which depends on the metric span of E. But now here, instead of something which really depends on E, we have the integral over the set, the sublevel set. And again, the proof is essentially what we did before. You apply the LP Remes type, the LP Remes inequality for Lebesgue measure, and using this inequality, you replace and you get the following one. Everything can be done also in higher dimensions. Now, but our goal is to generalize this structural theorem to also to control sets which are discrete, and this we do in the most natural way. So instead of considering the Lebesgue measure, we just need to consider the omega relatively dense. This is what we the new notion. So we would like that the metric span of E intersection with a cube of size 1 for the moment is bigger than a certain constant gamma for any translation. And actually, there are very trivial examples. So in the case of R, you just take the grid of, I don't know, 1 over n. K over n for n, which is, whatever, you can choose whatever you want, bigger than 2. So this is like some kind of grid for which and this is an omega relatively dense set. This is very easy to show. Okay, so what is the structural metric log Venenko-Serda result that we have? So we have a function which satisfies both Remes and Bernstein type inequality. Now E, it's a relatively omega relatively dense set with those constants, and then we have absolutely the same thing. The only thing that actually, where is the metric span? So the metric span is hidden in this constant gamma. So the proof follows from the structural theorem with the obvious modification, but maybe just one question that still we have here. Maybe this is not the right quantity that should be here. Maybe something more delicate and really, which depends really about the properties of the set E. So, because you should think that E could be now a discrete set in R. And still, we would like to have something here. Maybe it should be a sum with respect to all these elements. But of course, the integral is the most natural and quantity, but maybe there is a question and something we are still considering maybe this can be replaced with something else. So let me just show you the proof. So it's as we showed before, we do this partitioning to good and bad intervals. So we showed before that the LP norm of F on the good interval is bigger than the LP norm of F on R divided by 2. Now the set, our set, is relatively omega relatively dense. So the metric span of EI is bigger than gamma. So again, we can apply the metric span LP Remes type inequality. So the integral over V is bigger than this integral, but this is bigger than gamma, and therefore we get this gamma here. And now summing up over all good intervals as before, so the integral over V is bigger than the integral over V over all the intersection with good intervals, and then we can apply 16, and so we get this constant outside, and we just get the integral over the good intervals, but good intervals is bigger than the LP norm divided by 2, and this is the 1/2 that we have here. Okay, thank you very much.
More questions? Other questions? Not.